So the first thing you want to do is visit your city. Go in and talk to the building official, find out who's in charge, get some contact information, and stay in communication with these people so that you can find out if you can build a garage. You want to find out if there's any kind of criteria, constraints, or obstacles that would prevent you from building the garage. So there's no point in planning a garage build if you can't actually build one. So with my own garage build, the building official told me that I had to build the garage 5 feet away from the property line. And I looked up the city ordinances on the city website to verify that information. So you do want to cross-check your facts that you get from the people you talk to. As you can see here on the city website, you can see a checklist, requirements for submitting plans, and 11 by 17. And as a homeowner, I'm allowed to do all the work on my own property, including electrical, plumbing, mechanical, and building, as long as it's up to code and it follows the code books for each of those different types of construction. Take a look at your permit application. Find out how you do your inspections. If they come within 24 hours, how often they need to be. Is there a minimum amount of lag time between inspections? Things like that, that your city might actually have requirements that you need to follow. So you need to take a look at the 2015 International Building Code. At the time I built my garage, it was the 2012 Building Code. And I was lucky enough that the International Building Code book was available at my library. I could sit there and study it, take notes. And I also checked out some electrical books that I found easy to read, diagrams and things I could follow, rather than looking at the actual electrical code book itself. However, this book also referenced the code book, so I could always fact check the information I found in easy to follow electrical code books. So you want to find a quiet place to sit down and study, maybe even have an abacus available so you can do any math and calculations. I like to put on some glasses so I look sophisticated as well. Once you find out that the city will allow you to build a garage, you can start looking up all kinds of resources, different manuals from the manufacturers of the building components you will be installing. So the OSB will have installation manuals, the vinyl will have installation manuals. So you just want to find all those resources so you can install them according to the manufacturer specifications as well. In some places, the foundation has to be really deep, like 3 feet underground. In other places, the foundation can be slab on grade. So look up some websites, some forums where you can search answers and questions, and you can also ask a question and get answers. Create a list of engineering firms in your area in case you have to have your plans stamped and the city requires that. You can also have the engineering firms maybe even draw up your garage plans if you need to. So with my own personal experience, I actually know how to do blueprints in AutoCAD and I actually made them myself. I went to an engineering firm and they actually didn't even charge me. He just took a look at it and said I needed to add a few more things and he said it looks really good. It looks professional. So I went to the city and they thought I purchased the plans and I made those myself. Your plans are also a way to communicate to the city. So you want to make sure they're clear, concise, accurate so that the city can review it and just approve them. Once you design the garage, you can actually count the number of building components you need for the construction. The number of studs, the OSB, the linear feet for the electrical wiring, vinyl siding, and I created my own estimated cost sheet for all the materials I needed to purchase, and I split it up into three parts as to the finish, wood, and hardware, and I put the SKU number from the Home Depot website. So all I had to do once I had my list completed was go to Home Depot, order everything all at once, and it only cost $75 for them to order all of my building materials in one trip. The only drawback is that you have to find a place to store all the materials that you won't be installing right away, like the drywall or some of the OSB. However, a big benefit is the discount, which could be 8, 9, 10%, which saves you several hundreds of dollars. I also created a price sheet for the framing members, the pressure treat and the Douglas fir, the different lengths, and that helped me quickly create an estimated cost sheet. So make sure you get estimates on anything you're not doing the work yourself. The trusses I did not build myself. It was a lot easier to just pay about $1,000, get them delivered. And with these long framing members, I did not have to worry about lining things up. It was very easy to install. It only took a few hours. And you can actually install these by yourself. However, I did have somebody help me because it's the first time I put in trusses. Now, I didn't do the concrete work myself, so I did get estimates on the concrete and the excavation, but labor only, so I had to create a cost sheet for the concrete as well, and different various thicknesses in the driveway and the slab in the garage, because that will definitely affect the cost. So when you get the estimates for the contractors, make sure you get at least 3 estimates, and a lot of them are free. I would still increase the price of the estimate because they may not have accurately estimated it, and you just want to make sure you have enough money available to complete the project. And ideally, it would be good to keep a small percentage of the payment at the end of the project, about 10%, to make sure they complete the finishing touches and you can pay the contractor in full when they are done.
So just to share my own personal experience, I planned my garage build even before I bought my house. So when I went around looking for homes, I found one that had a very small amount of square footage. The price was really low, but it also had no garage. The location was good as well. So then I started looking at the next house, and this one has a lot more square footage and the location is good, but the price is very high and it has no garage at all. So I ended up settling for something that had a good location, the minimum amount of space that I needed, and the price was really good, and there was no garage. So then I spent a lot of time thinking about the garage, how I was going to build it, and the financing. And I checked with the city too to make sure I could build a garage before I even bought the house. Now, when I started to come up with the plans and to have it approved by the city required me to have it 5 feet away from the property line. So this caused a problem for me because I was going to also use the garage to back up my trailer and store it in the garage. So with 8 inches of concrete, 6 inches for some framing, I would not have enough room between the fence and the house to maneuver my car in order to make the curvature that I needed with the trailer and have it back up into the garage. So all I had to do was just ask questions, find out if there were exceptions to the rules, under what circumstances, and just see if I could meet those requirements. So then I submitted some plans to show a build with 2.5 foot distance from the property line, and the building official accepted that, and I was very lucky, and now I'm able to back up my trailer into the garage and park it right behind the red dashed line. And of course, the fun part for my garage was to plan out where I'm going to put all my woodworking machinery. And I was very careful to make everything to scale, and I have enough room to actually fit my trailer in there as well. And so if I ever need more room, I can actually pull out my trailer if I'm working on a very large project. And with the table saw right by the garage door, I'm able to rip to width with the garage door open and then cross cut within the garage, also a 4x8 sheet of plywood. Now, I could have removed the middle partition and just made one very large garage door. That would have cost more and it would have been a lot more planning. I would have had to have carefully designed it. And then the concrete work would also have to be perfectly level all the way across. Also, I didn't want there to be a lot of sound coming out of the garage. I don't want to open a large door, allow sound or heat during the wintertime or the coolness inside there during the summertime to come out. And so I would rather have the two door. And with this garage build, the walls are soundproof. And of course the floor and the ceilings are also soundproof. The garage doors are not soundproof, but it still creates a 90% soundproof garage. A lot of the sound is still damp and it doesn't bother the neighbors, and you can't really hear it in the driveway very much when I run all the machines. So it did work out really well. And then also, just to give you some feedback on the soundproofness and the way it was designed, I noticed that with the ridge vent, the air inside the garage is very cool during the summertime on the hottest part of the day between 2 p.m., 5 p.m., and then when the sun goes down and everything starts to cool down, the garage also starts to cool down, and it's actually not very warm in there at all. I think it may be 80 degrees maximum. And that's with no cooling devices or shade from trees or anything like that. And I think a lot of it has to do with that ridge vent allowing the hot air to escape continuously throughout the day. Thank you for watching. I hope this helps you with your own garage build or a large project you might be interested in making. A lot of people jump right into the financing part or the cost of the build. And really, you can always get a loan or you can always reduce the size and make the cost work for you. And so I would check with the city first, because some city ordinances don't let you build anything at all because you've already maximized the buildings on the property and you can't make any more buildings because of the square footage, or there might be some underground lines or things, easements or things like that. So I would check with the city first, and then you can look into the different resources that are available to you the different manuals for the construction building components. And then you can start going into the cost and the timing and when you're going to be building it, the delivery of your materials, and you're planning it out for several months, and how often you're going to have inspections and things like that. And always create some lead time, so you just want to make sure you have several extra days available in case you run into bad weather or any issues. And with my own garage build, I also got the average weather for each month for Salt Lake City during the entire year. So I actually planned the framing during June, which has the lowest amount of rain. And then I could build the framing and then get the OSB on and the asphalt shingles on before it even rains. And so you want to check averages for the weather during the year. And don't forget to exercise if you plan to do 10, 12-hour days. So you can see I'm doing a lot of forearm exercises for the hammer. I worked on my back, my shoulders to be able to lift things onto the roof. And I also worked out my legs with the leg press and triceps and biceps. So about a year before I started the garage, I even exercised more than what I usually do.
Don't forget to watch the time-lapse video, which shows you the entire construction of the garage build, so you can see how much work is involved from start to finish. Thank you for watching, and remember, when lifting heavy boxes, lift with your legs, not with your back. So thank you for sticking around. As a bonus, I'll show you my actual cost of the garage build. You can see here all the different materials I purchased for all the different areas of the garage. And this is the material cost. Includes the concrete as well. I paid somebody to do the concrete work, which was a really good deal. So I did save a lot of money in that part of the project. Of course, the concrete for my project was a little more expensive than just the garage because I also did the driveway. I hope this helps with your planning. If you have questions or comments, make sure you post them down below and I'll take a look at them. And if I don't have an answer, I will find the answer for you and just tell you where you can go to get more information.